Yeah, it is like coming home. Whoosh. Yura. It's a Burundi Bupa. It's a Nunuku Kondamupa. Yura. I'm speaking in somebody else's country. And it's a great honour to come back as a point of, I guess, a testament to both their teaching and my learning of the power of exactly what this topic is about, Aboriginal knowledges, particularly in the second decade of the 21st century. So I'm going to give you a few cautions and warnings that this seminar will not go in the usual didactic lecture talking at you. It'll feel that way in the very beginning. But believe me, folks, me standing here looking at me is not going to help you. You really need to focus on the beautiful images and slides because they are more compelling to look at and understand the yarn I'm going to take you through. Now, Felicia's going to try and help me control this because I just get so excited about this that talking is, I would do it forever and a day. And I think that's part of, you know, what we have as a pleasure and a benefit, though we don't often feel this in higher education, is exactly that. Why else are we here? So I'm going to take you through some layers here in layering. So you probably need to buckle up, because by the time I get you to the end of the beautiful images and the visual knowledges, I'm going to expect that you'll have some comments or things to share or questions or whatever else, and then we'll take it into the next phase, okay? Oh, it's just gone dark down there. Welcome, Mob down in Townsville. I can see some familiar faces there, as well as in here. Thank you for coming. And I am genuinely sincere about that because I had the privilege of starting these huge learning knowledge transformations in Townsville and ended up here in Cairns. And I always declare rainforest people are the best teachers that I've ever had the privilege of sitting alongside. And as an early childhood educator, that process is highly important about how we engage and also how we give back too. So part of what I'm doing here is not just talking to you, I'm giving an honour back to country. So here's a little bit of a way I sort of start to contextualise this. The map actually has no kind of absolute relevance. It's just a good visual form because it's one that we're all familiar with, and it'll help, you know, rather than locate. Where some of the other peoples of, you know, what you're going to hear a little bit of, and some of you have heard a lot of at various points in time, about what I think I know and how I get more excited about what else is to be known, particularly working in higher education. So Kondamupa, land of the country of the Noonuccal, Noongi and Gurumpul peoples outside of Brisbane there. I'm currently living in Bundjalung country. So they have a role to play in what you're getting today too, because a lot of my thinking and resting and replenishing is done in that beautiful country as well. Going a bit further up there, the other red dot is my mother's country. I'll show you a little bit about that. And of course, rainforest country, which is absolutely exquisite and significant in their way of their knowledge immersion, if I could put it that way. Especially to teach a saltwater person like me with these types of contextual understandings and layers in particular. And I also want to acknowledge peoples from Baliu community who invited me to work with them in early childhood business and who taught me another exquisite layer of how to be not so much human, but more particularly about how to be humane. And I think that's one of the key messages that I want to leave you with, that the power of Aboriginal knowledge actually has that. But I'm not going to answer the question title first, so I'll probably, before I forget, is that the role of Aboriginal knowledges in higher education is that it's already here, that we just don't get the proper way and chance to kind of sit together and distill that, if that's the right type of process to use. But it is here and it is happening. But there are certain ways where it can be erased or silenced or diminished. And yet, in spite of that, other powerful knowledge forms occur. And I'll show you Karen Martin's theory of how this gets to be. on the Mukul country. Some of you will have been there, yeah? So this business here, it's not Italian, that's waves like that, see? Rolling through. So when I'm really animated, tides up, okay? So when I'm feeling, you know, a little bit soft and things, I'll put my hands together like that just to ease that. That also comes from my mother. My father's a saltwater man. We're Uluburuba, people of the sand and salt water. Now, this is where I start to get you to tighten your seatbelts just that bit further. Because the image on the right is one that's more commonly understood about Mindrapa. You often hear it called Minjeriba. English does bad things to strong Aboriginal vocalizations. So I'm restoring that as a knowledge form. So it's called, it is actually Mindrapa, not Minjeriba. Now the one on the right is a tourist map. So that's how tourists will see it. One road that goes up the island and one road that goes across. And guess what it's called? It's called a trans island, right, because it goes across. How about that? So 2/3 of that country is mined for its silica and rutile. And we've currently got an application before the High Court because the Queensland government want to extend the mining company's lease for another unbelievable length of time, phenomenal. But they don't give back to the community. If you've been there, you'll see how bumpy the roads are, and you'll see how the community doesn't have infrastructure for people to, you know, get together and relate. It's all about taking and taking and taking. Now the image on the left is my representation of the very same thing. And I can do that because that country knows me, first of all. Now, my older brothers and sisters don't represent their knowledge in this way, shape and form. But they accept and perhaps concede that this is what Karen does. But it means, you can see that it actually means more. Now, do I need to know what every dot and line tells me? No. Because that, to me, is what I would say is the database for Kondamupa, or in this case, Mindrapa. And the serpent name and rest on that side is one of our creators, the carpet snake. So my knowledge evolves and is replicated and reproduced around knowing that Kabul is always in that country and that country is always in me. So I don't have to know what every dot and line is because I know what it can look like and what it can feel like. And I can do a search of that if I have something that's troubling me to help me clear things away. So in our terms, there's no such thing as right or wrong, or good or bad. It's just clear or unclear. Now this is an interesting thing, because this is my mother's country, Carnarvon Gorge, and she's a Bidjara woman from that area. And I've only been there twice, and then the second time I was allowed to take these types of representations of country, because I don't take photos and I don't go into country unless I'm actually either taken by someone else or invited to. And therein lies the power of an Aboriginal knowledge system, is that the ontology, the worldview, as well as the axiology is embedded in that place. It's actually hard to distill. So you know how to behave. You hear what I said then? You know how to behave. You don't just behave, right? And when you behave, you know more about yourself and the country that you're in. So that's why it's always important to have someone take you there. Or when you're a person that's, you know, quite capable, you may be allowed to do it yourself. My PhD studies was done with the Buru people, the Burungu, up at China Camp at the head of the Bloomfield River. And people would always ask me, have you been to see the Roaring Meg Falls? And I said, no. And they were troubled by this because they had in their minds this set of like tourist types of activities that I should be doing. And they said, doesn't that trouble you? You know, how can you say you have a certain amount of knowledge about the people in the country? And I said, but I've never claimed that I did that. I've always said that I came alongside, came amongst first, and then came alongside in certain types of regulation of myself in their country and of how they were showing me how to behave. So to go to the place that's of heightened importance to them is that I know it's there, but being there is knowing that it's there is enough. I didn't actually have to physically see that. So that's the trouble with the image I showed you before, when the tourists come to Stradbroke Island in peak tourist season, they outnumber the population 10 to 1. So if there's a permanent population of, say, around, like I'm going to average up to 4,000 people, that's 40,000 people. And there's probably right now, into the middle of December, starting to increase and build. And they'll stay there in various waves across until, even up until February, when school starts again for some of them. How country copes, I have no idea. But I do know country can cope, and therefore as a person, as a human who lives and engages with that, that it's a lesson for me about this managing oneself and coping. So this whole thing around, you know, what's Aboriginal knowledge has all got triggered from our native title. And you can, you know, I just said before there, we're not done. Like, so if there's a lot of a myth around what native title is and how Aboriginal people might be cheating other people out of certain kinds of things. And especially we're apparently cheating the mining companies out of potential income and profits, you know, like they'd miss that. But this is quite a dated image, so you can see December 2002. And basically in the majority of instances and representations of Aboriginal peoples and higher education is something like this, that people already have a stereotypical iconic kind of image in mind, and then the behaviours to go with that. And if you don't fit that model, then they will dismiss you, but then you go on a journey of actually finding out what that really and truly means. So it's just like showing you the distinctions between how tourists would see my country and how I see my country. Now, if I was to give you the choice, I hope you'd want to say, not the one on the right, that you'd want to start understanding and knowing and behaving in country by, you know, as much as can be shared from that image that I've represented, and I call those first stories. Now, I should also say too, that as an Aboriginal woman, I cannot, and I'm going to be clear, I will not pretend to bolt on the term Torres Strait Islander. That's not my way, and it's not my business. But when I'm talking, there's a space that fits behind the term Aboriginal for when folk of Torres Strait Islander ancestry are come alongside that as well. So I can only speak from an Aboriginal position, but that shouldn't be misunderstood as being exclusionary, because that's not our way either. We've been welcoming people to these shores since the 14th century. It's just only in the 16th century they decided to stay. They decided to stay, and that's where we're at. Okay, so what's this mean? Well, from dialogues and, you know, the expansive types of experiences that I've had, I come down to understanding that when we're all working off the same terms of reference, right, like that first map on the top left-hand corner, we can engage quite openly and readily. Like, we're starting off at the same point to dialogue, because that's a map of Australia, obviously, isn't it? And something we're hugely familiar with, and there is information that we can actually take for granted and then make some assumptions about, and it won't matter necessarily. But when we get to something like the top right-hand side, it actually starts to draw up the troublings, because unless you know what the terms of reference are to be able to read that map, then we could be guessing until, you know, into the night of what that actually means, doesn't it? So what I'm saying is sometimes what you see may trouble what you know, or may prompt you to think, I don't know, and then a sequence of responses might go, so I'll just wait for someone to give me the answer. But I'm going to ask you, what do you reckon might be the terms of reference for that top left-hand map? Hang on, they've gone. Oh, they're back. What's the terms of reference for the top left-hand map? What's it saying to you? What could it be saying? Look,
this is a good example. Anyone from Townsville? I'm wondering if you've got lots of thoughts and ideas, but you don't actually want to share them in case they might be wrong. Is that kind of, right? Yeah? Is that sort of halfway there? Because you're clever people, and this is an awkward space here. It's not.
So Karen's Josephine born in Apple.
Yeah, Josephine.
So could you just ask the question again, please?
Okay. What do you think the terms of reference are for being able to understand and or read and then know the map on the top left right hand corner?
The first thing that comes to my mind, Karen, is statewide borders.
Yeah, okay.
And borders based on Western knowledge.
That's perception. Yeah, that's actually perception. You know, I've used this map a number of times over years. You're the first person to ever respond in that way. So what I would hear then is actually about getting past the confusing question about down to how there's still a consistency in the way that it's divvied up. You want to be left off the hook?
Yeah.
No, come on, you have to have a guess. You have to have a guess. What might that be? Pardon?
I was muttering.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I was thinking it's temperature or rain.
Thank you. It could be. Yeah. See, it could be. So, am I making, probably not, but there's a point that I want to make here is that, you know, Josephine and me are the only one yarning here. Thank you, Josephine. Because everybody else is waiting for that moment when Karen will go, ta-da! Right? Now, this is my point about Aboriginal knowledges in higher ed in the 21st century. You're waiting for the moment when the Aboriginal people will go, ta-da! Folks, you're looking for the pot of gold without realising the beauty and the power is the rainbow. There is no ta-da, it's already here. All right, I'll have to talk to my assessment colleague about this. But the other offers that I've had people share is a weather map, and this one is actually about Australia's magnetic fields, right? But now we only know the top level. We don't know what's the difference between pink or blue or green or whatever else, hey? Yeah. So you see the different layering that goes on here? And I'll tell you a really interesting story. We could do the same process for the one down on the bottom right-hand corner, because we can take for granted it's a map of Australia, the continent of Australia, and the Torres Strait and Tasmania. But this one still has the same layers and colouring, but you already know what that is, don't you? Yeah? Okay, because here comes the bit where I'm going to flip you and ask you, now that I've taken you through those other ones, what's this? What is this? Margie, we go.
Sorry, yeah, I'm just going to say landmass.
Yep, good. Good. Someone from Townsville?
I said that's home.
Home. Okay. Yeah. See, now you're applying your own meanings to it, because we all know and can take for granted what that wriggly black line with the dot at the bottom of it means. Hey, that kind of means open to interpretation, doesn't it? Which can be risky. Whereas the others limit that layer of interpretation. And it's the interpretation and meaning that you can give to the very same thing where the issues of where Aboriginal knowledges are valued or they're tokenised, in my opinion. Okay, so you're doing pretty well on that one. Because often I hear when they get to that point that the term culture is used instead of knowledges. But I'm constantly asking my question, are they the same thing? What do you reckon? I'll tell you the Karen Martin worldview of it. No, I don't think they are at all. Not the way that they are taken for granted, like the images and the maps and the layers of knowledge and understanding and interpretation to it. Because when you talk about Aboriginal culture, your mind will flip straight back to what that judge was doing to that Aboriginal man. Those iconised, stereotypical, essentialised representations of Aboriginal peoples in particular. And this also happens for Torres Strait Islander people. Okay, so can we agree that cultures evolve and therein knowledges do too? So why do we still persist in trotting out the same representations of Aboriginal peoples and Aboriginal knowledges as those kinds of cultural types of icons? To me, that's a bit of a sickness in a certain kinds of way that needs some very careful thought and dialogue around exactly that. More particularly, how should we understand them now that it's the second decade of the 21st century? And this was taken from the representations that people working with young children from 3 to 5 years old over rely on as part of their cultural content regarding Aboriginal peoples. So I'm not saying it's wrong. I am saying if that's all they're doing, we are in trouble. They are in trouble too. And our kids are in trouble too. And I need to make it clear, I'm not saying that that's wrong. Because they come from a particular disciplinary and a particular, they are theorised in particular kinds of ways and constructed and represented and given voice to in certain kinds of ways, anthropological, legal and sociological canons and native title indicators. I can tell you that when we did our native title claim, I probably, if there were 7, I met 2. So I actually thought, you're not going to tell me who I am, because I know where I come from. So I'm not wrong. And you'll notice that in Noongar people in particular, Quandamooka people, you've got to have a good argument to kind of convince us this. So then I thought, okay, how do I find out where these things went wrong? And I'm starting to rest on how the distinctions between different discipline areas of bodies of knowledge, broad bodies of knowledge, get applied and particularly get misapplied in relation to us. Now, I also realised that, well, what else is there and what else could there be? And I thought, well, there's a nice, you know, journey till the end of my days. I'll see what I can pull together when I yarn with lots and lots of people. Okay, and that's part of the power of coming away from home, is that you actually learn more about it. So here's some of the ways of the usual terms that Aboriginal knowledges is constructed and applied. They're called cultural beliefs, right? So there's no grunt in that. That can be really dismissed, and I'll give you a little story later about how. Or it's called traditional knowledge, or spirituality, cultural practices, cultural knowledge. You could probably add a few in as yourself. Customary knowledge, ecological knowledge. Here's how I say we need to start opening up that type of dialogue and reclaiming some of this place and space. Because of all the Aboriginal people I've ever had the privilege to know, and family mostly, and then others as well, and Torres Strait Islander people, here's the suite of how I describe how they do things and as informs knowledge constructs and knowledge application and replications. It's highly intelligent. In fact, I'd argue that it's supremely intelligent that we didn't need to write it down in script, because it was planted. That's just the word that come over the top of my head. It was embedded into a context for a particular time and a particular purpose. Not just land, waterways, skies, climate, plants, animals. Last of all came the people. It's absolute genius. Now I've had, you know, those I've been listening to the radio up here, you know, people kind of latch on to the 40,000 years of Aboriginal people in the country. No, science actually says it goes further back than that. But here's where the disjuncture occurs, because they can admit that paintings in Western Australia are hundreds of thousands of years old, but they won't admit that the people who produced the paintings have been there that long too. So something wrong in how that's actually being portrayed and represented and erased in particular, which is what Terra Nullius did from the beginning. Here's the big one. It's about that nation, that notion of sovereignty, about how we stand in country, but equally how we stand in somebody else's country. Because the biggest honour is to be able to come back and particularly speak in country. So anytime I'm able to do this, it makes me feel that I've been a worthy learner. So that's who I am. What I do in my professional role in higher education is to try and be a worthy educator. To me, there's a very strong connection of in relationship to that. They're complex. And I think that's part of where the disjuncture actually occurs, because when we start, people start to look at Aboriginal knowledge into a particular discipline, the discipline area, or an academic area, it undergoes certain types of changes that are not always beneficial. And people end up invariably teaching those iconic or stereotypical types of things, or they teach content as descriptions. So, obviously it takes a long time to develop curriculum and design that towards that, but I'm actually saying in the second decade of the 21st century, why aren't we further ahead than where we were, 30 years ago when I did my undergraduate degree at Kelvin Grove at Brisbane College of Advanced Education? Seems to me we may have moved, but there's a place of inertia that's kind of ripped us into a time warp. And here's where I'm going to suggest where we need to start thinking about the complex levels that Aboriginal knowledges are highly theoretical. Now, I don't know about you, but I've never heard of anybody refer to Aboriginal knowledge or Aboriginal theories. It's usually Aboriginal beliefs or Aboriginal customs or spirituality or something of the sort. Believe me, our worlds were so highly theorized to an exquisite level that you manage yourself in relation to knowledge, and then you will know more, because you can't know everything. And how do I know that? Because they're based on what I'm arguing are intellectual traditions. And I would say that they are the things that are evident, particularly where Aboriginal peoples and Torres Strait Islander peoples are working in the academy across time. And I'm not talking about the symbolic representations, they form a part of that, but I'm talking about where the real intellectual sweat occurs, particularly in curriculum design and implementation and evaluation. That's the boring part. Now I'm going to loosen up a bit. Okay, because I reckon I'm good at this, because I'm teaching people who work with young children who are on the fabulous journey of acquiring vocabularies and understanding what words mean and the impact of those words, right? Those of you who've parents and grandparents will recall the delight of that small child when they realise the impact of the F word, right? So what I'm suggesting is, what if we were to bracket or erase and take out that word culture from the vocabs? What if we were to call it Aboriginal intellectual traditions or Aboriginal theories? Because I'm going to give you a quantum upper example of Aboriginal theory based on intellectual traditions. Now, I don't think a couple of people might have heard this story before. It's a real good one. Saltwater story. So apologies to people who are not used to that. But the sharks down home there are racist. They are. You know why? Because they don't eat black people. They don't eat our mob. Now you see how I put that to you? So you right now you should have formed the answer of who it is they do eat. Hey. Now remember earlier, I told you about the expanse of the population on peak tourist season time. So I hope your brain's making the connections here, because that's an Aboriginal intellectual tradition, right? So guess who it is they eat?
The tourists.
Yeah, of course they do. Now, they're the tourists because when you're a tourist, you just do what you think you want to do in the moment, anywhere, anytime, anyhow. We don't get eaten, right? Not because we know the nature of sharks and how sharks think. You'd have to be a shark or know sharks quite well to be able to pull that off. But we do know the context and the theory, the modelling, theoretical modelling around how to be safe in the house of the sharks. And it begins not in salt water, it begins in fresh water. And we teach our little fellas how to manage the relationship in a freshwater place. And down home it's Boomera, Brown Lake. And they're only able to go out in the water to their belly button. Right? Now that's quite liberating and powerful for a young child. Because the adults don't have to stand there interfering with them. Now inevitably, you know, that's they fall over, of course they do. But they can get back up again because the belly button's actually a good place, you know, and the, you know, the locus of control for themselves means the adults can be in a particular position to watch, and often it's not an adult, it's an older child, right? So when we can see that the further out they go because they're getting taller, because the belly buttons are, you know, also rising, means they're going further out, getting deeper, and then they start to do risky types of behaviours in the fresh water, then we start to say, okay, time to introduce you to salt water. Now, gender-based knowledge, I only know it from the land base. If you want to know how to manage your relationship in salt water that's deeper, then you have to talk to some of our men. But what I can do, and these are now the layers of the theoretical construct, is tell you how to read where the gutters are by the waves are falling and breaking, and the big no-brainer is whether the tide's in or out, you know. But for some people, particularly tourists, that's not something that comes into their brains. But there's another trick too, because it's reliant on, again, the freshwater, because if there's a freshwater seepage, then the waves will move the sand around a lot more, the deeper kind of gutters will form and longer, and you can tell again by the way the waves break in there. Now, if the waves are breaking like that, that's real delicious stuff for the little fish, because they'll come and eat those little real microbes. And after the little fish are there, then the medium-sized fish come in, because they're going to eat the little fish that are eating the microbes, right? And then comes the bigger kind of fish. You see where I'm going with this? And then comes the sharks who eat the big fish who are chasing the middle-sized fish who are chasing the little-sized fish, right? And all of those layers, and I probably haven't done it justice that I'm telling you here now, are things that are part of our intellectual traditions that all of our children are imbued in. Becomes part of their DNA as much as that salt water knows. Now, earlier I'd said this is not knowledge about sharks. It's knowledge about the context and how to manage yourself in the same context where those sharks will be. Now, the other big one is that we say to them, because this is as much as I can do, if you can't see your feet on the ground, you're in the wrong place. Now, Western science will tell you that the bull sharks love murky kind of water. Now, here's the other big clincher too. They also love dogs. So people who swim with dogs in murky water are amping up their potential as being shark dinner at any point in time. Does that make sense? Now, you could apply the same kind of modelling through to other kinds of understandings and intellectual traditions, and therefore theories, and therefore knowledge. So, you know, planning a beautiful image of a shark on the wall and calling it a Kornamupa shark story won't have that same meaning, will it? Because it has to be contextualized. It has to be given validity and reliability in relation to a context and a purpose. Because if you're not using it, why do you need to know it? know, I get perplexed about Facebooking and all that kind of stuff and how that goes. And thinking, okay, thanks. Good, that's good, I'm tracking my time. So, you know, in a like yourselves, folks, in those moments where, you know, you get that those 3 minutes where you've got clarity and you have this powerful idea and you're going to turn it into a research project, you don't want to talk about, eh? Yeah. And this is kind of where I landed and got tracked, where I started tracking it to, because education is my background. And folks, I'm going to be honest with you, I decided, 2008, that I could not and did not want to be teaching Aboriginal studies in an education degree ever again. Ever again. Stepping is too racist and too violent, and the systems don't support you in that. You're just delivering a service, apparently. No. Right. Getting the distance then from that has helped me be able to comb through, you know, which part of it is just the scared Karen part, but which part actually tracks down to how we can make changes in terms of curriculum. Because curriculum brings with it a theory, and curriculum ultimately, according to my colleagues in my school of education, that's another way of organising knowledge. So too is Aboriginal intellectual traditions. So if we start to think smarter and clearer about how we can find ways to go beyond embedding, but to what I'm suggesting as curricularising Aboriginal knowledges, then I reckon we're on the curve, you know. I reckon we're on a curve because I can tell you that those classes, and I've talked to colleagues who have done the same thing as me, bolted because it's too violent, too hard, too crazy, or those who are still there, it's hard to teach and it's hard to be a learner in those contexts, especially if you're an Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander person teaching, and especially if you're an Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander person as a student. I'm being straight up with you here. We haven't got time to muck around, you know, kid ourselves, you know, on the types of reconciliation, you know, that people are going to get it. Well, it's the second decade of the 21st century, and whilst I still live in hope, I'm not convinced that dragging out the reconciliation Trojan horse again is going to achieve where we're at. So this is my what else kind of response. So I'm saying that when people start to believe in, and I'm not questioning in those cases where people believe that it's absolutely necessary to have Aboriginal knowledges as part of a program that's offered in a university, what starts to happen is they start to consider more about their discipline area. And immediately that discipline area has turned their heads away from the Aboriginal knowledge. Bit like the two maps of Stradbroke Island earlier, right? So now you've got the case of fitting the fabulous deadly one, and I'm going to say that because I did it, but it's actually about my country, and into that other model and frame, right? It's almost incommensurate. Then we start to get to the point where we make decisions about curriculum. You know, what parts of our discipline area can be taught, and how and when and why. And where? And yes, we have to deal with if this is a 13-week program or a 1-week intensive. So these are the things that we're navigating, mediating these knowledges. So then we get down to the P, which is about the professional knowledge, because most of the courses or programs and degree programs I'm talking about here, where Aboriginal knowledges and Torres Strait Islander knowledges is sitting amongst other disciplinary knowledges are often requirements that to graduate those students need to be able to tick boxes and say, and in education there are two standards to say that they understand Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples and cultures and histories, and that they are able to teach Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander students. Now they're huge demands. And I'm aware that they occur in the health professions and particularly medicine and other ones as well. So what you start to see happening is there's a real impinge down on the big A, which is the Aboriginal component. and it often loses out. It either gets pushed out or it gets minimalized to a way that I'm going to put it like this. It gets curricularized down to being like a cardboard box, you know, or an IKEA flat pack. Put this together, but the instructions don't actually make it clear. Does that make sense?
Yes. You know? It's, folks,
we're dealing with layers of knowledges here, and the notion of embedding shouldn't be a bolt down. I'm actually saying it should be both and. But where we need to turn the attention to is how we organise our curriculum, how we make the decisions from, you know, the unit level, you know, the subject level, across a year level, and then across the whole degree and program, because that one foundation unit or capstone unit that is the once-off experience for everything you think you'll be able to need and know about Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples. I don't even know what to call that. It's just something that gets done. How do I validate this? Because I know I don't work in a vacuum, even if I have these big crazy ideas. The Indigenous Higher Education Review of Access, of the Barrett Review, 2011, Recommendation 18 said, develop and implement an Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander teaching and learning strategy. You mob got one? I can tell you Griffith doesn't. And I can tell you on a quick, you know, run around of the colleagues that I work with in other institutions, they don't have one either. So what if we start this mobilisation around under a teaching and learning strategy? Because we, in the same way, we have the broader teaching and learning plan or a research plan. This work deserves the same level of oomph. Otherwise, people are just going to feel like they're just plugging holes like they have been for the last 20 years, that same feeling. We don't want to be doing that anymore. We're smarter than that. It's the second decade of the 21st century. So here's the issue though. Folks, we're going to get beyond all of the nice kind of discursive yarns and dialogues about the contested areas. We just got to get on and do it, because it is the second decade of the 21st century. And there is a phenomenal amount of work that is available to tap into. And we have to look at it again in the second decade of the 21st century and then make not intellectual decisions, folks, these are moral decisions about whether that flagstone, foundation stone or capstone unit gets support by other units throughout the whole degree program. Now that would be a gold standard in my opinion, but it is doable, and I actually believe that it's absolutely necessary. So where we might have Aboriginal studies considered as a point on one end, and this is where this discussions around contested, Aboriginal studies is a contested field. Well, what are you saying? That Aboriginal people are contested too? Sorry, we're still here, and don't talk about us like we're not. And contested in relation to Aboriginal knowledge down this other end. If you're working on a continuum, you're in trouble. You're in trouble, because on a continuum like this means that it's either or. Right? We can do this or this. We lose out, students lose out, the academic staff lose out, people lose out generally. What we want to do is try and change that to from the transactional and interactional to a relational model. Because Aboriginal people will continuously say, you'll hear people say, you need to know how we think and why we think that way. Or they will say, you need to come on country so we can show you. Now, if that's happening, they're not asking you as a tourist. They're asking you as a masterclass to be taught in a particular way through their theory, in the moment, and in context. Just like if you came to Stradbroke and you said to me, Karen, tell me about your cultural beliefs about sharks, and I'd push you in the water, especially after you hear me yarn here. And if you said, Karen, tell me about your intellectual traditions about keeping safe, then I'd show you right there and how. And when Aboriginal people take you, say, you need to come into country, it's actually saying to you, you need to undertake this masterclass. But if you're thinking about this as a studies episode, then you're just going to do a tourist curriculum. And guess what? You're going to miss the point, so you're going to go and do it again and again and again with other mobs in certain places and times, and we'll end up with that crazy mash of those four images that I showed you there before. Aboriginal knowledge is already in the academy. But there needs to be a shift from a transactional and interactional model to a relational and ideally a transformational model. Here's how I'm going to take Griffith University through the same way. That one on the right there, that's the Griffith University representation of their footprint. This one on the left here, guess who did that? Same message, but a very, very different focus on being relational, not transactional or interactional. You don't need to know where the road is on that one, because you can see where the rivers and the coastline are, and the campuses. But so that makes that information over there a bit redundant. But these are the kinds of dialogues that we need to have. And I'm not going to say that it's easy, but I am going to say it's absolutely necessary. What do you reckon? Because I'm going to finish on that. Over to you. No, they've gone all quiet. That's wrong.